Hello everyone, this is Gary from Fantastic Fundas and we are doing lecture 3, the Marathas. Before this, in lecture 1 and 2 we finished Mughals, and if you have do not remember those lectures or you have not seen them, I would urge you to click the link above and go and see those lectures. And if you have not seen any of the lectures, I would urge you to see the introductory lecture first and then come to lecture 1, then 2 and then 3. And lastly, if you do not remember anything, please go to lecture 2 again, revise it. We'll also revise it today. But if you want to remember history for all your life to come, so please listen to lecture 2 again and then come to lecture 3. Moving ahead, I'll give you a quick review of all the Mughals. This will take me 5 minutes. I'll actually write it for you. So in Mughals, okay, I'll write it for you. This will take me a moment. Okay, let's change the color so that it looks better. So the first one is Babur. Babur came in 1526 and he stayed up to 1530. I'll be speaking very fast. Try to catch up with me. He fought in the first battle of Panipat. Babarnama was the book. Babarnama was translated into Persian by Abdur Rahim Khane Khana, and he defeated Ibrahim Lodi in that first battle. Then after Babur came Humayun, and he was there from 1530 to 1540, and then he was there. Then there was Surampire, managed by Sher Shah Suri. Then he came back again in 1556. And Humayun, we know Humayun Nama, and Humayun's tomb is in Delhi. It was built by his wife Hamida Bano Begum. Humayun Nama was written by his sister, whose name was Gulbadan Bano Begum, the body of roses, Gulbadan. And in that book, because it was written by a female, so it contains the condition of the woman also. Then came Akbar, and Akbar was here from 1556 to 1605, and greatest of all Mughals, Ain-e-Akbari, was a statistical account written by Abul Fazl, and he built so many buildings: Fatehpur Sikri, Agra Fort, Akbarnama, Buland Darwaza, and so many other things. Then after Akbar came Jahangir, and we know that he had liking for art. Jahangir was also known as Salim, and Jahangir was from 1605 to 1627. And Jahangir, he was interested in painting, and his wife Noorjahan had pretty good influence on him. Noorjahan also got the title of Padshah Begum, and then we can come down to next is Shah Jahan. All of us know about him because he built Taj Mahal. Shah Jahan was there from 1627 to 1658, and World Heritage Site Shahjahanabad, he built Taj Jama Masjid. And then after Shah Jahan came a very cruel Mughal king. His name was Aurangzeb, and he is also known as Alamgir, and he was here from 1658 to 1707, and this is the year 1707 from where the modern history will start. This is beginning of modern history, and actually it is here that decline of Mughal start. And Bahadur Shah, see what he did. Aurangzeb, he imprisoned his father, and then up to 1666 where he died. And why did there was downfall? Because though the empire expanded to its largest extent in India, but there was a downfall, and downfall, the reason of downfall was over centralization. So these were the what are known as earlier Mughals, right? So this is that's it. And now we'll quickly move to the later Mughals, and the later Mughals included beginning with Bahadur Shah. Bahadur Shah I, if you remember, I gave you the formula. He is the first Shah, so he is also known as Shah Alam. Later on we will read about Shah Alam II. towards the end of the Mughal Empire, and he did many things. For example, Battle of Jajao, Guru Gobind Singh Ji guided him, he made him understand spirituality also. He gave Sardueshmukhi and not Chauth, and so many such things. Battle of Logar took place at his time. So that is it. And Bahadur Shah was the king from 1707 to 1712. After Bahadur Shah came Jahandar Shah, and Jahandar Shah was there from 1712 to just for 1 year, 13. And he at this time Zulfi Ali Khar the Noble, he started playing prominent role, and he started is prominently known for Ijara system, and I will not be explaining here. For this you must refer to like video 2. And then came very important king whose name is Farooq Siyar, and he was there from 1713 to 1719, a very very important period, you must remember this. And Banda Bahadur, he was captured this time, and if you remember there were two people who came to him. Chauth and Sar Deshmukhi was completely given, and Hamilton and Sirman, William Hamilton and John Sirman. William Hamilton was a doctor, he came to him. Farooq Siyar ka shikar karne gaya tha, doctor, usne shikar iska kar liya, to doctor ki zarurat padi, to doctor Hamilton aaya. And this is also known for Magna Carta of British trade in India. I'll just write it for you because this is important. Of British trade. And after Farooq Siyar came two people. One was Rafi Ud Darajat, and other was Rafi Ud Dola, and this was just in 1719. Again Sayyid brothers had a big role in their coming. Nothing much happened. Just to remember is this, Rafi Dola was also known as the Shah Jahan part 2, and that's it. And we can just put it here, this is Shah Jahan part 2, and I'll just put a line there so that it's easier for you. So next king that comes over here, can you recall it? Yeah, if you can recall it, good. It is Rangila. So just to put the numbers, first was Babur, Humayun, Akbar, Jahangir, Shah Jahan and Aurangzeb. Those make it 6. This is Bahadur Shah 7. This is 8. And Farooq Siyar is 9. Rafi Darajat and Rafi Uddola, they make it number 11. And number 12 is Rangila, and Rangila's time period is from 1719 to 1748. You know a lot about him. There were a lot of he's a Rangila man. So there are two people Rangila. One is Hrithik Roshan, other is Farhan Akhtar, who is also known as Roshan Akhtar. And since he is Rangila man, at his time music will come over. So a new form of for dance came at that. That is famous as Kathak in UP and Khayal type of singing. The two musicians in his court were Niamat Khan and Firoz Khan. So that was about Muhammad Shah Rangila. I'm not going into much details. And then number 13 will be that was Ahmad Shah. Ahmad Shah was 1748 to 54. Nothing much about him. All we know, Qadasiya Begum was there. I told you about a garden in Delhi, and at this time there were invasions by Abdali invasions for 20 years. And then after Ahmad Shah Abdali came Alamgir II, and this person was there from 1754 to 59. And you can imagine that now he did security pact. Alamgir II, the one particular thing about him is that he did security pact with Imad, promising him security of northwestern frontier province. And this is one of the things that led to third battle of Panipat in 1761. And Abdali recognized Alamgir II as emperor, Imad as Abdali, would Abdali the person whom these five people were fighting. Abdali recognized Imad as the vizier, and this time Rohilla chief Najib Khan was also very popular. Then came number 15, which is Shah Alam part 2. This guy is also known as Ali Gauhar. So what was this man? He took part, of course, in first battle of Panipat, battle of Buxar was there, and then before that Nawab. See, who all were the people? There were three people in Battle of Buxar, just to help you remember them. One was Shah Alam II, other was Shuja-ud-Dawla of Awadh, and then third was Mir Qasim. He was the Nawab of Bengal. And Shah Alam II, he gave the Diwani rights away. He gave Diwani rights for what? He gave Diwani rights for what? To Bengal, Bihar and Odisha, BBO. And to English, and this time it was Delhi was captured by Lord Lake at this time. So we are left with just two kings, and I'll just change the color so that we can write it properly. So that is like number 15. Number 16 is number 16. Number 16 is Akbar II. He is the person who sent Raja Ram Mohan Roy to England to fight for his cause. And then last king is Bahadur Shah Zafar, and you know about him. So that was all about Mughals, and now we will quickly move to the Marathas today. So rise of Maratha Empire, how did it all happen? We'll talk about it. So 18th century was the age of Maratha supremacy. When we say 18th century, what does it mean? It means from 1700 to 1799. Now, biggest reason was the decline of Mughal Empire. Why did Maratha Empire rise? The reason was Mughal Empire was declining. So, as I told in earlier lecture also, other people started rising. There is a strong tradition of war and courage in Marathas. We know that Marathas are still very proud people, and they are rightly so. Culture was very important at this time, and devotional music was very popular, and songs of Marathi saints like Namdev were very popular, which are known as Abhangas. What are Abhangas? Abhanga is a Hindi word. If you can read Hindi, I'll write it for you. Abhang. Now, this is made from two words. Abhang. Now, Abhang. Bhang means end. A means that cannot be ended. So, unending. So, that is how it was. They pray, used to pray God Vitthal, and also known as Vithoba, and he's a Hindu god. Other saints out of this who used to pray Vithal was Eknath and Tukaram. Such people were there. Then they would also sing Powadas. Powadas are the reciting love lyrics and heroic ballads. So these are particular way of singing. We need not go into that detail. This is the family structure of the Marathas, Maratha kings, that you have to remember if you want to understand Maratha history. Maratha history is as such not that important, because very few questions are asked from Maratha history. Nevertheless, you must know this history, because even one mark can make a difference. Now, it all starts with Shahuji Bhosle and Jijabai. They are the main people, and their son was Shivaji, who is very popular in whole of India. Shivaji had two sons. One was Rajaram and one was Sambhaji. And Sambhaji had one son, Shahuji. Just you can pause the video here and try to remember this. Shahuji Bhosle and Jijabai, son Shivaji. Shivaji son Rajaram and Sambhaji and Shahuji. I'm telling you, in no book, you will find such simplified history of Marathas as in this video. It took me a lot of time to make this, so you must remember this now. Now, what happened when Sambhaji and Shahuji were captured by Aurangzeb? Now, they were captured by Aurangzeb. So, in the meanwhile, Sambhaji and Shahuji could not become the king, so Raja Ram became the king. So, this Aurangzeb was somewhere between 1658 to 1707. So that is how it is. Next is now they fight a battle of Kher. We will discover in this slide that how battle of Kher started to Peshwaship. Now what happened when Raja Ram became the king? He took Marathas to the new height. As I explained in the earlier slide, that Raja Ram was the king. Now Raja Ram died of unspecified illness in 1700. Because he died in 1700, from 1700 to 1707, that is when Aurangzeb released Shahuji. It was Bahadur Shah. So when Bahadur Shah released him, during these 7 years, there was nobody to rule. So there came a lady to rule whose name was Tarabai. I'm sorry for this. Tarabai was wife of Raja Ram, and she took the rule. Now when Shahuji was released, she went to Tarabai to take over the kingdom as it was his right. But she refused and did not budge. So there was Battle of Kheda. Now where is this Battle of Kheda? Kheda kahan par hai? Kheda is a place near Satara on Bhima River. Now Shahuji won this war, and he was helped in this by his future Peshwa. You see, you have to remember two things. In Maratha Empire, two things run parallel. One is king, one is Peshwa. We will read that how king was very popular. Shivaji was a king and Raja Ram was a king. Shahuji was a king. But after that comes Peshwaship. We will talk about Peshwaship in detail. And the first Peshwa is Balaji Vishwanath, who also helped Shahuji win the war. And then king will get weak, but though he will continue to exist. King bhi rahega, Peshwa bhi rahega. King kamzor ho jayega, lekin Raja to Raja hi hota hai aur Peshwa junior hota hai. Lekin Peshwa ke paas paar badh jayegi. Aur fir eventually Shahuji succeeded Raja Ram as the fourth Chhatrapati in 1708, and he died without son. So for this time being grandson of Tarabai, this lady who was wife of Raja Ram, her grandson, uska pota Raja Ram part 2, he came to power for a small while as a king. He was a king, the kingship was there. Now this time Shahuji was busy. In the meanwhile, Shahuji was busy when Shahuji was alive. He was busy fighting Duranis in Afghanistan, and power started slowly shifting to Peshwas, and Balaji Vishwanath was among the first of Peshwas. Do not question the loyalty of the Balaji Vishwanath to the Shahuji. Shahuji had realized that there was no going back to days of centralized monarchy of Shivaji's time. That centralized monarchy sari par center mein aisa possible nahi tha. Now how did Peshwaship develop? The Maratha imperial structure got the form of a loose confederacy. What do you mean by loose confederacy? For example, if there are like 10 areas, let's say only 4 areas, this is all of Maratha Empire. There are 1, 2, 3, 4 areas. All of these were very independent in themselves. They were not exactly controlled by the center Maratha king, but then they also had to give something to the Maratha king, let's say some money or some contribution in war. Now in its different chiefs were having separate sphere of influence, but they recognized the authority of Peshwas and supremacy of Shahuji. So whenever, even though Peshwa was getting stronger, but the Maratha whole empire, it's like the whole of the India is there, and Punjab is there, Jammu Kashmir is there, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and Manipur, Meghalaya, Arunachal, all these independents there, all of them were stronger in themselves. There was more of federal structure, we can say, but that would not be the right word, just to understand it. Now, what were the main states at this time? One was Gwalior, one was Baroda, one was Indore and Nagpur. Gwalior was ruled by Sindhias. We still know that Lok Sabha seat is generally won by them, and their chief was Ramoji. This is not important, but you must remember state and ruler. Baroda was with Gaikwads. You still find a lot of Gaikwads. Indore was Holkar. Recently, there was property issue regarding this issue of the queen of Holkar in Indore, Holkar queen. So you must know this name very well. And then in Nagpur, you still find large number of Bhonsles there, and Nagpur had Bhonsle rulers. Now Bhonsles, they are basically, this is the family of Shivaji. You can remember this easily. Now what do you mean by Peshwa? Peshwa means the foremost who became important because of the skills both in military and diplomacy, and not just that. Peshwaship means prime minister, as most of the books are saying. Now what the Peshwa word is of Persian origin. Now I will take you to a very complex thing. This is the Peshwa ship. So how did the Peshwa ship develop? I have written the years. You do not have to remember much in it. If you can, that will be good. But if you don't, that will be fine. First try to remember the names, who followed whom, and then move on to years. Pehle naam yaad karna, fir saal yaad karna, dono ko ek saath yaad karenge, kuch bhi nahi yaad ho payega. तो फर्स्ट वी स्टार्ट विद बालाजी विश्वनाथ. बालाजी विश्वनाथ के बाद जो पेशवा बने वो है बाजीराव वन. हैड टू सन्स, वन वाज बालाजी बाजीराव एंड अदर वाज रघुनाथ राव. बालाजी बाजीराव इज आल्सो नोन एज, फेमसली नोन एज नाना साहेब. नाना साहेब हैड थ्री सन्स, विश्वास राव एल्डेस्ट, देन माधव राव सेकंड सन, एंड थर्ड सन वाज नारायण राव. वेयर इज रघुनाथ राव हु वाज द ब्रदर ऑफ बालाजी बाजीराव, दैट इज नाना साहेब, हैड ओनली वन सन, एंड दैट वाज बाजीराव टू. राइट, Now, if you see this much structure again, Balaji Vishwanath, then have Bajirao. Bajirao 1 had 2 sons, Raghunath Rao and Nana Sahib. Nana Sahib had 3 sons, VMN, Vishwas Rao, Madhav Rao, Narayan Rao, and Raghunath Rao had 1 son, Bajirao 2. And Narayan Rao ji, he had 1 son whom he named Swami Madhav Rao. Right? So we have the years also there. So we first will talk about all these Peshwas quickly. The first Peshwa is Balaji Vishwanath, 1713 to 1720. He was the Peshwa. See, he got the title of Sena Karte in the Battle of Kher. In that battle, he had helped Shahuji win against Tarabai. That was in 1707. Right? 1707, Battle of Kher. You must remember all these facts. Please listen to the video, rewind it, re-listen it. Do not move till you remember these by heart. The first Peshwa, he is also known as the second founder of the Maratha Empire. They helped in release of Shahuji and help Maratha, as I told you. Now, help Marathas. What did he do? He helped Marathas by asking for Chauth and Sar Deshmukhi from Farukh Siyar. And while we did Farukh Siyar today also, I mentioned, but got it from Rafid Dujarat, because Farukh Siyar only gave them partial rights. And this is also known as the Magna Carta of the Mughal dominion. Now then came Bajirao Bajirao, and Bajirao was there from 1720 to 1740. Now you must focus on the map at this side. If you see, he was a great Hindu warrior, and what Bajirao ji did, he extended the Maratha Empire. This is Attock over here, and this is Krishna River over here. So his empire is right from Attock to Krishna River. And he made Maratha kingdom into a Maratha empire in the true essence. This is the huge extent of Maratha empire at his time. He gave the vision of extending Maratha confederacy, and he gave the concept of Hindu Pad Padshahi. This is an important word. You can expect this in paper. Who established Hindu Pad Padshahi? And it was Bajirao I, and he was the second Peshwa and son of the first Peshwa, Balaji Vishwanath. Now, he defeated Nizam of Hyderabad in the Battle of Palkhed. Now you have to remember battles, because they come in paper often, so you have to remember this. That cannot be helped. Palkhed, Nizam of Hyderabad in Palkhed. Next is he was known as the fighting Peshwa, because all his life he just went on fighting so that a Maratha Empire can be expanded. He shifted the capital to Satara and also attacked Delhi in 1737. Mastani was the Bajirao's second wife, Bajirao Mastani. She is famously known, and she was the daughter of the Chhatrasal king of Bundelkhand. And Rangila was the king, if you recall, at this time. And if you can recall Mohammad Shah Rangila, that guy, in 1719 to 1748, he was there. I'll just write it for you, 1719 to 1748. And of course, Rangila, Roshan Akhtar, Khyal, Kathak, if you remember that. Then he had 2 sons, as I told you above also, Raghunath Rao and Nana Sahib, and we will talk about them. Before that, we must talk about Nana Sahib now. Here is the portrait of Peshwa Balaji Bajirao, also known as Nana Sahib. Peshwaship was supreme now, because Shahuji had died childless. That is in 1749. This is a very important fact. When did Peshwaship become supreme? This is the year, because here king has died childless. Now Peshwaship, it's not Peshwaship, this is Peshwaship, this word can be omitted. Peshwaship became hereditary now. So agreement there was, here there was agreement now, because Peshwa is stronger, they will do agreement with the Maratha king. This agreement is known as the Sangola agreement. So many questions have been asked on Sangola agreement. After reading this, you will never do wrong question of Sangola agreement. Under this, all the power will obviously go to whom? Peshwas, because they are stronger. The Maratha policy of indiscriminate attacks on all regions. See, before I move ahead, I must tell you, after every Peshwa or the king, you should pause the video and think over it. Because I have to finish the video, I have to move fast, I have to finish this lecture in a particular time. But you must pause and think over it and try to recall and remember. And if you are unable to, please go back then and there and see the video again, that part. Now, the Maratha policy of indiscriminate attacks on all regions, including Odisha, Bengal, then Malwa and Central India, that everyone became suspicious of Marathas. They were expanding like anything. So, Raja Surajmal Jat of Bharatpur at this time, he advised Nana Sahib that when you go for fight, do not carry pilgrims and entertainers included with him while fighting. This was the question asked in UPSC also. Now, we will talk about the three sons of Nana Sahib, Vishwas Rao, Madhav Rao and Narayan Rao. As I said, VMN. Now, Vishwas Rao, he could not become a Peshwa. Why? There can be a question, true or false. Okay, you answer it for me. Vishwas Rao became the Peshwa after Nana Sahib. False, because he died in the third battle of Panipat in 1761. And along with Nana Sahib's cousin Sadashiv Rao. Now, Madhav Rao at this time became the Peshwa for almost 10 years. Very nice person, very able person. Administrative and judicial reforms were there. Accounts and treasury reforms were there. He defeated Nizam thrice. He even defeated Hyder Ali of Mysore. This is big thing because British were not able to do so. Now slowly Marathas will grow so weak after Madhav Rao that they will seek help of British in defeating Hyder Ali. Now anyway, he brought Rohilkhand Delhi under Maratha control, refused to be under influence of Raghunath Rao, that brother of Nana Sahib. He died early because of TB. Then came Narayan Rao. He died in war against Raghunath Rao. Murdered on order of Raghunath Rao, who wanted, actually he did not die in war, he was fighting. Then he was murdered on order of Raghunath Rao, who wanted Peshwaship for himself. He did not die in war, he just he fought. Now, so his son also came to power for small while, and there were regency having 12 important ministers. At this time, very prominent thing came called Bara Bhai, yeah, fir Bada Bhai, as you want to call it. Bara Bhai came. Those were the three sons of Balaji Bajirao, also known as Nana Sahib. Now, on 14 January 1761, third battle of Panipat started. Many Marathas died. Vishwas Rao, son, Sadashiv Rao, cousin, Ibrahim Khan Gardi, artillery commander of Balaji. So many people in third battle of Panipat died. Net Abdali won the war because of his superior generalship. Achha commander tha wo, he aur usne army supply card di thi Maratha ki khana peena aur jitna weapon tha, and centralized decision making. Impact of third world war. Oh, what I've done over here. This is not third world war. This is third. Okay, I was reading world history actually. This is third battle of Panipat. And should be read as that Maratha Confederacy was shaken and hollowness of the empire was exposed to the world. And Nana Sahib constructed number of pets. If you remember, pets still exist in Pune, which are called the neighborhoods. Now, here is the third battle of then came Swai Madhav Rao, also known as Madhav Rao II. He is the son of Narayan Rao. Now, in battle of Kharda, he defeated the Nizam under the guidance of Nana Fadnavis. So, there is also a saying, Jab tak Nana, tab tak Pune. Now, Raghunath Rao went to British, the brother who also planned the murder of the Narayan Rao. What he asked them, this led to first Anglo-Maratha war and it ended in status quo with the Treaty of Salbai. Treaty of Salbai is very important for slavers. Under Treaty of Salbai, there was to be peace for 20 years. And this is how a promise to recover territories from Hyder Ali, and British were found a reason to fight Hyder Ali, and this ultimately led to Anglo-Mysore war. Anglo means Angrez, Mysore to hume pata hi hai, that was in 1780-84, but this is the first Anglo-Maratha war because Raghunath Rao went to Britishers and they interfered, and because nothing much could come out of the war, and so there was status quo which ended in Treaty of Salbai. Then came Bajirao II. He is the son of Raghunath Rao. He's a coward, you can say. Not exactly, you should not write that in paper, but this is my understanding of the whole thing. For protection against other Maratha chiefs, he did subsidiary alliance with Wellesley via Treaty of Basin. Now, because he could not fight, he was not ready to fight anyone. So what he did, he goes to Wellesley. Wellesley is the Governor General. We will be doing all the Governor Generals in further coming lectures. He did subsidiary alliance treaty. That it means that Marathas would act as the subsidiary of British and British would protect the Marathas, and he was retained in headquarters in Pune by English. But other Maratha resented this treaty leading to war. They said, how can we subsidy of British? So this way there was so much of confusion. Second Anglo-Maratha war took place now because of other leaders of Maratha Empire, and Bhosle and Sindhias lost in that, and Holkers won. So but at that time they were fighting against Wellesley, but Wellesley had to go to England because Napoleon there got very strong and he was called back to fight with him. and that is Wellesley and Napoleon were to fight. So Britishers out of their no choice, they had to do a treaty of Raighat with the Holkers, right, and gave them all the territories back. So third Anglo-Maratha war after this took place in 1816. Actually, it was the last desperate attempt by the Marathas to take control of all the territories that they had lost in the second Anglo-Maratha war, but Lord Hastings this time struck back and Marathas lost, and Peshwaship was now abolished in 1818. Maratha pride was hurt, and to satisfy the Maratha pride, a small kingdom of Satara was given. Now Baji was exiled to Bithur and was given pension. English refused pension to Baji Rao to his adopted son, whose name was Dhundu Pant. This is important name. So he joined the revolt of 1857. After that, he went to Nepal and was never heard of. This way, Peshwaship was completely over from the map of India. So this is again the Peshwas. You can pause here, look at it. I've compiled all the war that I've talked about. This is you can pause and think over it. This is Khed. I will not actually give much time to this. But if you want, I can just put on this on play for you. You need not pause. This will stay here for 5 minutes. You can have a look. For example, this Khed and Pal Khed, Third Battle of Panipat. You can try to have a look at years and who fought and what was the result, which treaty resulted in these. You can have a look at that. Then I have a question of the day for you. Discuss how Anglo-Maratha wars helped British in establishing the foundation of their empire. I look forward to your answers to this question. This for 12.5 marks. Maximum you have to write 200 words for this, and you can send your answers to Fantastic Fundas. This is wrongly typed. This is Fantastic Fundas. Fantastic. There's no space between two letters. Fundas at gmail.com. So answer should be in PDF format or typed. Picture of answer should be very clearly, otherwise I will not be able to check. And please write your name, your email address, and whenever you write this, and also do not mention to write the question on your answer sheet. I would prefer it in written and per click form rather than type, but you can type it also. So in the next lectures, next two lectures, we'll be studying about Indian states. All these, for example, we have read about Marathas. Now the remaining people after Mughals, Hyderabad, Awadh, Kerala, Rajput states, Jats, Pathans, Sikhs, all the areas around Delhi. And finally, then we will be talking about Bengal. So that is it. If you like our lecture, please subscribe to our channel. We will be posting our history, current affairs, and much more to come. And if you like this video, please click on the like button, share it with your friends, that is our fuel actually, and you can put it on Twitter also. And that's it. If you have any questions, comments, observation or discussion, you can do it in the comment section. That is all. Thank you for watching.